Good evening, everyone. My name is Steve Edwards, the Executive Director of the Institute of Politics here at the University of Chicago, and it's so great to see all of you here with us tonight for the conversation about the new acclaimed biography of Michelle Obama entitled Michelle Obama, A Life, written by our good friend and journalist Peter Slevin, who's back in Chicago for this episode of his book tour. And he'll be interviewed tonight, of course, by Laura Washington, columnist for the Chicago Sun-Times and a recent fellow at the Institute of Politics. So we're grateful for the two of them to join us here this evening for what will be an illuminating conversation. It's part of our series of events here at the Institute of Politics, as so many of you know, where we engage many of the leading writers and diplomats and elected officials and policymakers today on key issues and players in the news today. You can find out more about all of our upcoming events online at politics.uchicago.edu. A couple of quick teasers coming up a bit later this quarter. We will have John Lee Anderson and Richard Engel talking about covering wars and conflict zones, two amazing acclaimed war correspondents. We'll also, in early June, have a session with former White House press secretaries as they reflect on their life in the eye of the storm, which should be illuminating. They'll be with us from across several different administrations. That will be coming up along with a host of other great events. Tonight's event is being recorded. You can catch all of our recorded events on iTunes U by searching U Chicago IOP. We encourage you to do that. And we also encourage you to follow us on Twitter and on Facebook. A bit later in the conversation, we'll go to questions from the audience. We'll give priority to student questions, but then we'll open the floor to all of you for your questions. And when we do, we ask that you make your question indeed a question. End it with a question mark. Keep it short and to the point so we can get to as many of you as possible. And without further ado, let me turn things over to Corinne Riley, who is a first year at the college here. She is studying history. She's from Lucca, Italy. She's very involved not just in the IOP, but also in the Model United Nations team here, and she's also a staffer of another Model UN entity here that many University of Chicago students know that's known as CHOMEN. Please join me in welcoming her to the podium to formally introduce our program tonight. Corinne?
Thank you so much. Once again, thank you everyone for joining the Institute of Politics speaker event out of the speaker series. So joining us today, as mentioned, we have Peter Slevin presenting his new book, Michelle Obama, A Life, The Chronicles of the First Lady's Journey from Chicago's South Side to 1600 Pennsylvania. This biography brings us details of our First Lady, not only from when she's been in office, but ever since her childhood here around the corner in the South Side. In fact, it shows us the tensions that she's faced from being, quote, frequently torn between different worlds, not just black and white, but also working class and elite, initially here in the South Side, but even later on in her life in college and in employment. Mr. Slevin is currently a professor of political science at Northwestern University, before which he spent a dozen years working for the Washington Post, covering a variety of topics such as the fall of communism in Russia and Eastern Europe, the Bush-Gore recount, and many U.S. foreign policy topics. Joining us, we also have Laura Washington. She's an ABC7 political analyst and also a journalist for the Chicago Sun-Times. She last joined us winter quarter, in fact, as a resident fellow. I was lucky enough to be one of her fellow ambassadors, and I'm obviously very excited and very happy that everyone here has the chance to listen in on one of her discussions again. So without further ado, please help me in welcoming our two guests. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Corinne. And Corinne, I don't know if this had anything to do with your selection tonight, but I'm thrilled that you're up there today, particularly because you're so interested in history. Because one of the things, Peter, I love about this book is the way you weave historical references and the history of Chicago, the history of the nation, the history of the civil rights movement into Michelle's story. And congratulations on this book. A spectacular feat of reporting, meticulously researched and detailed. And I think it will stand for a long time, notwithstanding the book that I'm sure Michelle's going to do. Yeah. It will stand for a long time as being a very powerful third-person rendition of her life and of the life of the Obamas, and I appreciate it. I wanted to start by thanking all of you for being here tonight, and I'm told that some of you were expecting to see the lady herself here tonight. I'm sorry, But you're not going to be disappointed. It's going to be almost like Michelle was in the room. Starting with why you did this book, obviously from Corinne's introduction, you have a very rich history in a lot of different subject areas, and this is your first book. Why this book?
First of all, thanks, Corinne. That was great. I am much obliged. And Michelle, as you all know, grew up literally around the corner, you know, just down in South Shore, not too far from 75th and Jeffrey. And Laura, thank you. You know, I'd worked for the Washington Post for a long time, and I was doing it from Chicago, getting here wondering, like, what am I going to really write about? What's in Chicago after being in D.C.? And it was just about the time that the guy with the funny ears, the weird name, was running for the Senate, and I found that there was something, well, maybe he's sort of interesting. And in the first presidential campaign, I followed her around, and I followed him around, and it just became so clear in watching her in state after state, and the way she connected, and the message she was delivering, that she deserved a book that where she was at the center of her own narrative, not just wife of the more famous Barack Obama.
And what was there about what you saw and heard that made you feel that way? I mean, every first lady, most first ladies have had a book written about them, but why this?
There were several.
How did it speak to you?
No, it's a great question, and there were several things. I was intrigued by the way she had to give up her old identity. You know, remembering that Michelle Obama had a 20-year professional career on the South Side, 10 of them as a working mother, quite independent of Barack Obama. She then decides to back his presidential run. And he has said, and Valerie Jarrett and others have said, she had veto power. If she said no in the late 2006, he would not have run. But in order for him to run, she had to, in a sense, reinvent herself as a political person, backing his campaign, validating his campaign. And so what I saw out there on the campaign trail was her ability to connect with voters of all kinds. Remember how important Iowa was and how unlikely it was at the time that Barack Obama and Michelle Obama could win as many hearts and minds as they did. And I was fascinated by her message. I mean, she went into that campaign and said, if I'm going to be part of this enterprise, then I am going to be true to myself and my values and what I believe. And she was delivering a message that is, you know, rooted in the South Side and true today, which is she's talking about inequality, she's talking about unfairness. And I was fascinated by the way she was able to do that as an independent voice in the campaign.
Now, you talk about the South Side, where we are right now, and that being a crucial part of her identity and her success. Talk a little bit more about that. A working class family, lived in South Shore. What was there about that background that made her so impactful and successful? And how did that, how much of that rubbed off on and helped Barack Obama?
Sure. Well, that's a great question. So Michelle Obama was born in 1964, the year that the Civil Rights Act was passed. But in working on the book, I came to understand how important family was to her. She would say, you all might remember in the 07-08 campaign, the voice I hear inside my head when I'm trying to decide whether I'm making a good decision is my father's voice. So who was her father? Who was Frazier C. Robinson III, who went to DuSable High in 1953? And she talks about her mother as the rock, as the person who was sort of steadfast and disciplined and always with her. She says, I can go up to the third floor of the residence where Marion Robinson lives, and I can cry, and I can complain, and I can argue, and my mother will say, now, okay, that's fine. Now just go on and do what you're supposed to do. So the book was part of the book was to figure out, so who are these characters? Where did they come from? And that led me to her parents and to her grandparents, three of whom came in the Great Migration. And I think these values that she talks about, this tension growing up that her parents also felt, growing up in a place where, in a world where the deck is stacked against her because of her race and because of her class, and yet also hearing the message from her grandparents and her parents, as her paternal grandfather said, your destiny is not written on the day you're born. Get out there, you can do it, you can be something. And that is, to finish kind of the thought that goes with your question, that's what she's talking about to this day. Those are the very same messages she heard growing up.
And how did that connect with the president? And how did that help him essentially become the president?
Well, I think there are a couple of ways to think of that. One is her friends describe her. One close friend from Chicago, also from the South Side, lives not far away, said, Michelle is the most do-what's-right person in Barack's inner circle. The president could look to Michelle and hear from Michelle how his ideas were playing. She would say, according to her friends and her staff, you know, Barack, that's not what people want to hear. That's not how you convey this. That's not how what you're trying to do will connect in quite the right way that you want. She is direct with him. She always is honest, Valerie Jarrett points out, with him, although she also says, the President of the United States doesn't always need to hear me haranguing him the moment he walks across the threshold to dinner. So she says she picks her moments. But I think that she, you know, I write in the book that if, you know, you remember in 2004 when there was that, you know, he gave that soaring speech that caught everybody by surprise in Boston, red states, blue states. And, you know, he was flying high. And I write in the book that in a way, if he's the helium balloon, like she's holding the string, keeping him grounded, keeping voters' expectations in check. You know, she'll say, look, this one man cannot solve all of our problems. So she plays a lot of those anchoring roles, I think.
What role does she play in the White House? I assume that she had some say with him, some sway with him about policy, about positioning. Mm-hmm. How often was she involved in those conversations, and how did she handle it?
Now, there are limits to what I know about the inside White House story, and I don't pretend to know what they're talking about at night, you know, over drinks.
You mean you didn't have a little microphone under the pillow?
No microphone, and I'm not going to make it up, right? So that was important. But there are some things we know, because he talks about it. He talks about how he values her opinion. But I also think it might be interesting to think about who Michelle is not in the White House. You know, these roles, if you walk in as First Lady, there is no playbook, right? There is no certain thing you are. You have no constitutional authority. You command no armies. She is not Hillary Clinton, for example, who set out to do policy. Remember, Hillary Clinton embarked on something far more ambitious than Michelle Obama ever tried. She ran healthcare, and it, of course, went down in flames. Michelle came in and said, you know, I'm not going to be in charge of policy. That's not me. I'm not going to be Rosalind Carter, who sat in on cabinet meetings. And there are little notations that Jimmy Carter would have on some of his policy papers. What think, Roz? She's not going to be Eleanor Roosevelt, who wanted a federal job, right? What she wanted to be was to wanted to do was carve out an agenda that was that dovetailed, that worked, that supported Barack Obama's agenda, and I think something that was true to who she has always been, which is that notion of, as I write in the book, unstacking the deck just a little bit. Mm-hmm. And you could easily talk about her policies and kind of what
well, you know,
them.
one of the policies that struck, that jumped out at me was your discussion about her position on LGBT rights and how she was ahead, along with a lot of other people, ahead of the president on that. Could you talk a little bit about that? And also, are there other examples of that where she helped bring him along, or where she was ahead of him and had an impact?
I think we can look at LGBT rights as being a very consistent with who Michelle Obama is and what she cares about. When you think about how broadly she's about opportunity and she's broadly about equality, and she's seen so much in her life that is neither of those things. You all will remember that in 1996, when Barack Obama was first running for state senate for Alice Palmer's seat, he filled out a couple of questionnaires from gay rights organizations in which he was asked, well, do you support gay marriage? Do you support full rights for gay people and lesbians? And he said, well, of course I do. And that sort of went by the wayside when he entered national politics. And David Axelrod has gotten some attention in his great book, if you haven't read it, The Believer, his memoir, for saying that, in fact, he thinks that Barack Obama pulled his punches on that. And I think many of his aides think so. But Michelle was working with gay and lesbian groups, attending functions as long ago as 2004 when he was running for Senate, standing in for him. And she has been a voice in the administration and in his circle who has said to LGBT organizations, this will happen, give us a little time, we're with you.
Were those public conversations?
Those were not public conversations.
Because at the time when the debate was on about whether he would step out there,
Right.
I don't think people were aware that there was that behind-the-scenes conversation.
She is very careful about what she says when she says it. She knows she's not the president. And I think it's fair to say that certainly in the first term, her goal was to make sure he got reelected. Mm-hmm. I mean, when she was in, you know, with him.
Things have changed in the second term?
I think they're very much the same people, obviously, but they're freed. They're a little bit liberated. He's not running for office again. And I think we can see in his statements, and certainly in hers, a willingness to say a little more, a willingness to talk a little more openly about inequality. Fairness and inequality, you know, fighting against that, I think, are very much what they're up to. You remember when she, you know, did the Boko Haram Bring Back Our Girls mm-hmm. thing. She went with Barack Obama when there was a demonstration for immigration rights on the Mall and was willing to say something. She tweeted on LGBT issues, you know, her support for Michael Sam's football player, to Robin Roberts when she talked about her partnership and so forth. And I think she's speaking out still carefully, you know, guardedly, but more. That's my sense, at least.
Let's talk a little bit about your research. As I understand it, the White House didn't throw open the doors and say, come on in.
I have not been to dinner over there yet. No, it is a fact.
Limited access. Talk about how much access you got, how you went about getting that, and then how you were able to move the book along without having and getting the information.
Yeah, I appreciate the question, and it is an answer that requires some nuance. Mm-hmm. There was sort of episodic support, some access that I got from her staff, but the vast majority of the sources, and there are dozens and dozens of them, were sources I developed myself. Many, fortunately, were people I had met while writing about the Obamas in 07 and 08, or even a little later when I wrote about the Urban Health Initiative on the South Side, who knew my work, who thought I might be okay, figured they could trust me. And I explained to everybody I interviewed what I was about, and also what I was not about, what this book would not be. It would not be a Washington book. It would not be kind of a cardboard cutout political book. I wanted to write a rich biography that was nuanced, and I also said there will be no anonymous quotes in this book. Hmm. So everything in there, anytime anybody says anything, a name is attached. And so a lot
of it... How did that promise about the anonymous quotes, how did that help you get interviews and help you get access?
You know, when you think about what I was asking, or for that matter, what any reporter asks, we are asking people to trust us with their stories. And I explained to everybody whom I interviewed that I did not want this book to be about my voice, mm-hmm. but I wanted it to include the voices of people who knew Michelle, who knew aspects of her life or of Chicago life at the same time, let's say, as her father was coming up. And in fact, would be her voice as much as I could establish it from earlier interviews I did do during the campaign, as well as interviews she has given since. I think it probably, you know, when I'm asking people to trust me, it was helpful to be able to say, I'll read it back to you if you're concerned. I want to get it right.
In fact, I don't think it was refreshing. You're right. It's not an inside the Beltway kind of a book, and several reviewers have pointed that out. And that's a fresh, good thing. And the word "I" in terms of referring to yourself does not come up in the book at all until you get to the acknowledgments.
The acknowledgments. I do say "I" a couple of times.
No, a couple of times I missed those.
That's right. But, no, that was quite intentional. Mm-hmm. You know, this is not a book about me. And I conveyed that to the White House too. Of course, I sought access, and I would have loved to have had more access than I got, and not just to her. I mean, even keep in mind, you know, there are two fabulous writers who've written Barack Obama biographies: David Marinus and David Remnick, the editor of the New Yorker, each of whom has won a Pulitzer Prize. And Barack Obama gave them what, an hour, mm-hmm. 90 minutes at the mm-hmm. most, for 600-page books. So it wasn't about whether I could spend time with Michelle Obama. I never mm. thought that would happen. But I certainly was pleased when dozens and dozens of people were willing to talk to me, and there's still a few more, I could have spoken with. And some of it was just, you know, old shoe leather reporting from being a reporter. You know, I went and tried to start tracking down some of Michelle's family. And so, for instance, I went very early on to see her cousin, Capers Funé, who converted to Judaism and runs a synagogue in Englewood, and said, you know, here's what I'm trying to do. And he said, well, that sounds all right. And told me some stories about Michelle's father. And he said, well, you know, you ought to talk to Nomini Robinson. Nomini Robinson is Michelle's uncle, her father's next youngest brother. And he graduated from Hyde Park High. So I went down to Hyde Park High, you know, learned about his career. I went and saw him. And he told these just wonderful stories about the Robinson family.
Mm. Why do you think Michelle Obama would not talk to you?
Well, that's another one that
I can't. Perhaps, because they have some.
You know, that's another one I can't fully answer. Yeah. They have their reasons. There are a few things that I do know. One, of course, is she will write her own book, and who doesn't want to tell their own story? I mean, that makes sense. I get
why
that.
Why give up all the good stuff?
Right, and why give up? It would not fully surprise me if she was not hearing from her book agent, as other writers have heard. You know, don't give that stuff away. That's your meat and potatoes. But I think there was more to it than that. I mean, I think this is an East Wing being where the First Lady's office is, that is, depending on how you look at it, particularly good at controlling its message, or particularly controlling about controlling its message. They choose their audiences very carefully. They target her message in many ways. And I think when they're setting up their cost-benefit analysis, they're saying, well, what exactly is this going to do for us? Now, of course, my argument was, a whole lot of people are going to read this book and review this book. And once it's out, it's not about me. Nobody cares about what Peter Slevin thinks. People are going to read it to find out about Michelle Obama. Don't you want even more of her voice in there? Don't you want to make sure that it's really right? Mm-hmm. That did not get me anywhere. I'm sorry to say. We do try.
And you haven't heard a word that we were talking about.
I have not heard a word. That is correct. I did get them books, you know, just, you know, I was very clear also. I mean, this is sort of in the context of how I presented myself. You know, from the very beginning, I said, this is a transparent project. I will answer any questions about what I'm up to. There are no secrets. There is no agenda. And so even when they were not talking with me, mm-hmm. I kept them posted. You know, book's coming out, or I'm still trying to get in touch with so-and-so. And then when the book did come out, in fact, even before I sent copies to anybody else, I did send some to the White House.
Well, in this case, probably no news is good news, because if they didn't, if it was something they didn't like, you would have heard from them.
There is a precedent for
the White House coming
down on writers.
I want to talk a little bit about race, because that's something that you can't escape, nor should you escape in the Obama story. And you quoted very early on in the book a friend of Michelle's, Verna Williams, which I thought is this quote that really struck me, saying, "So many people have no idea what black people are really like. They feel they know us when they really don't." Mm-hmm. Why did you include that quote, and how did that apply to Michelle's story?
I used that quote. Now, Verna Williams was a Harvard Law School classmate of Michelle's. She was president of the Black Law Students Association, and they were very close. And that comment from Verna Williams actually follows a comment from Michelle herself in the book. And this was in 2007. When she was just beginning the run for office. And the notion that Barack Hussein Obama could be elected was a little far-fetched to an awful lot of people. And she said, you know, the media often distorts who black people are. We see little bits of ourselves in the media. We do not see the whole story. The fact is, she said, Barack and Michelle Obama are not different. You just haven't seen us before. And I felt that one of the objectives of the book needed to be, I mean, she's in a sense asking a question, so who are we? Mm-hmm. And I wanted to tell that story. And you cannot tell that story without talking about race.
Mm-hmm. And when you talk about race, sometimes it gets ugly. And sometimes her story, or at least the way people have talked about her,
or
portrayed her, has been ugly. And you cite a number of examples. I'm sure everyone in this room has picked up on and heard some of them over the years.
That's right.
But things, very uncomplimentary things are said about her physical appearance. Mm-hmm. Just nasty, nasty stuff. And some of it's coming from Fox News, but some of it's coming is coming out on comments on the internet.
That's right.
What was that about? Some people think that has a lot to do with race. A lot to do with her being African American.
There's absolutely no question but that some of these remarks are racist. Mm-hmm. Now, she gets criticism. It's important to distinguish these comments and the criticism of her. She gets criticized from the left, particularly from women who say, She went to Princeton, she went to Harvard, she had a 20-year professional career. Why doesn't she do more? We've heard that. Mm-hmm. She certainly gets criticism for her politics. She's not shy about standing up on campaign stages and saying what she believes and what her husband believes. But there are, I document in the book, many, many examples of named individuals, inevitably all men, and in fact all Republican men, who...
All white men?
And all white men, of course, who criticize her body, who say the most vile things, who share photoshopped images, who, I mean, I won't repeat them, you probably heard some of them. And I thought it was very important to put that in there to show what she is up against. Mm-hmm. You know, here's a job she didn't really ask for, it's a realm that she doesn't especially enjoy. Why does she have to face all of that? And yet she does.
And is she
with grace?
Yes,
and I think one might add.
How would you? I know you haven't made a study, very first lady, but how? Where does she fit in the ranks in terms of the first lady? Who had, maybe Hillary's up there too, but the first lady who's had the hardest time with her critics.
I think Hillary obviously had lots and lots of critics, mm-hmm. but Michelle is in. I think, and I don't pretend to be an expert on all first ladies. She is in a category by herself. You might remember her very powerful remarks at Maya Angelou's memorial service in Winston-Salem, North Carolina last year, when she was talking about what Maya Angelou meant to her as early as, you know, when she first read her poetry as a girl, or her work as a girl, her poem, Phenomenal Woman. And she learned about Barbie, and she learned about being a black woman in a black woman's body. And she said, I remember loneliness in Ivy League classrooms, and I remember moments on the campaign trail when my very womanhood was questioned. So she heard those things, and she registered those things. And I'm sure other first ladies have been criticized for any number of things, but I'd be hard-pressed to think of an example where it is as mean and as tied to her race.
It's nice to hear that, because there's some people that would debate that whether or not race is behind a lot of this, and
I really tried very hard to, you know, to play it very straight, as the book is played entirely straight, and they're just documented examples, unquestioned examples with names and dates.
Another interesting thing, and this is related to the way she is portrayed and seen, you write, and this is a quote, she was not easily characterized, and yet public reaction to her was often binary.
Right.
This interesting word, binary. And then you give a couple of examples. Adore, abhor, respect, reject, warm, wise, and embracing, haughty, petty, and disdainful. These are, I assume, all words that you found that were used to describe her.
I have to say, those are words I invented.
Okay.
But I mean it. They were my synopses of how I feel she is portrayed. And she is broadly very, very popular. And in fact, she polls above 50% among Republicans as well. But she polls much, much higher among African-American women and then white women. Democrats, obviously, way up high. And yet the people who vilify her are stunningly dismissive of her. We've all seen it.
What's behind that? Beyond the race, you think it's, again, this comes back to race? Because some of this.
No, I think part of it.
Like you said about the left, women on the left who were criticizing her for not being left enough.
Not in those terms. Mm-hmm. I mean, those are still pretty respectful critiques and legitimate ones, right? What role should a woman play? You know, where do you fit it? How do you balance work and family? And where do those obligations lie? I mean, that's. There will never be a consensus, I think, probably on Michelle Obama in that sense, which we could certainly talk about. But I also think, I mean, I do not think it is all about race. We are in, as everybody in this room certainly knows, we are at a time of extraordinary political polarization. And you can see how she is portrayed as, you know, the leader of the nanny state, for example. That's a Democratic thing. I mean, that's the idea that, you know, she and Barack Obama happen to believe that the social safety net is something that is an obligation of society. They happen to believe that government actually can do some good work in expanding opportunity. And she made this very clear in the 2012 campaign speech, Democratic National Convention speech, which was, I argue, you know, I point out in the book, was a counterpoint to Paul Ryan and Mitt Romney, where she says that when you have succeeded, you do not shut the door behind you. You know, you open and invite somebody through, which you do personally, you do through civic work, and you do through government. And I think part of it is, you know, perfectly kind of respectable or respectful, well, not respectful perhaps, but certainly, you know, perfectly legitimate critique of her political views.
Mm-hmm. You've talked about the ways in which she helped keep Barack Obama grounded, mm-hmm. and their relationship and her connection to the community. If Michelle Obama had been white, would Barack Obama be the president of the United States?
If Michelle Obama were not Michelle Obama, he would have had a harder time being president. He would have had a harder time being Barack Obama. But to say it was just about race, I mean, that's a different, that's a conversation that's harder, it's an answer that's harder to come up with. Mm-hmm. I think there are many things that she is that have been hugely beneficial to him. Part of it was absolutely about the fact that she was able to legitimize him, particularly among many black voters. She went to, you know, if you think of her speech in Orangeburg, South Carolina, which was an important primary state in November of 2007. The campaign sent Michelle Obama to Orangeburg, to South Carolina State, both because of South Carolina State's history and because she can say, listen to me, you know my history, you know my story, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about it, and I'm going to tell you why you can trust Barack Obama. And in 2012, she did the same thing again. She validated him, and she said, look, I know everything has not gone so great. He's had some tough times. He's a good man. Give him a further shot. But beyond race and, you know, appeals to sort of certain demographics, think of who she is, how smart she is, how focused she is. He says it himself, how much Michelle's voice means to him.
Anything that surprised you in the reporting? I'm sure lots of things, but what's the biggest surprise? What's the biggest surprise?
Boy,
something,
great.
A myth or something that you didn't expect or that you that turned you around?
There were a couple of things. I loved working on, in working on the book, I loved discovering other characters, relatives in her world. You know, the Ora Higgins, who was a great aunt, but was alive until 2012, dying, I think, at 101, who was hired by Spiegel in the 1940s to integrate, not just like be one person to integrate Spiegel catalogs and Spiegel stores, but in fact hire hundreds of African Americans. Or her aunt, Robbie Shields, who owned the house with her husband, Pullman Porter, retired Pullman Porter, in South Shore, where Michelle grew up, who in 1942, as the youth choir director at Woodlawn AME, which at the time was the most progressive African-American church on the South Side, she goes to Northwestern, where she's invited to a choir workshop. And she shows up on campus, and they say, well, you can be in the workshop, but you can't sleep here on campus as a black woman. They did not use that word. So Aunt Robbie, 26 years old, tells Pastor Carey at Woodlawn AME, he gets the defender on board, and they march back up to Northwestern, and they find out what's going on, and they say, well, of course, you can't sleep here. We wouldn't allow that, not in this world, you know, you wouldn't be comfortable here, or, you know, some argument like that. Anyway, I found all of these documents about this, and so she sued Northwestern. So these are some people in her life. But if there were one thing that I was particularly struck by, it is, you know, we think of Michelle Obama as striding confidently through life. She is a force in so many different ways. She hula hoops on the White House lawn, something that, let's say, Bess Truman didn't do that often. She will feed kale chips to comedians dressed in drag. And she gives these remarkable speeches to girls all around the country. So what struck me was how often she talks about her own self-doubt and how Barack Obama said that he was attracted to her not only for her beauty and smarts, which were very real to him, but because he saw some vulnerability in her eyes. He wrote about it as the sense that life is terrifyingly random. And in this message, I think right now she is delivering this very potent and very heartfelt message all around the country and now the world. You saw she was in Cambodia recently, particularly to girls, particularly to girls of color. And she's using the power of her own trajectory to say, you can be me, you can do this. And part of that story is not, hey, look how cool I am. Mm-hmm. But look how hard it was, and look how unsure I was, and look how many people told me, I'm not going to make it. Or they would say to me, you know, she's saying, you know, they would say, your test scores are too low, or you're not smart enough. And she said, that hurt me. That helped, you know, that was tough, and I fought back. And so it's that sense, that willingness to share that self-doubt that I found very striking.
Makes me think of that exchange that happened about, said yesterday at the White House. Did you see the video on
that?
Where she was with a bunch of young children, was bring your kids to work day or something like that. And a little girl asked a question, and she asked her how old she was. And Michelle, there was a little bit of a hesitation, and she said 51. And then the little girl said something you couldn't quite hear, and she had the little girl repeat it, and it was like, You look younger than 51, something along those
and
lines.
I bet that didn't make her day.
You could tell, but there was that little moment of, again, that vulnerability, like, oh my God, I'm going to have to tell this little girl in the world that I'm 51, even though we know it.
Right.
And how am I going to be received? And she gave her a big hug when she gave her the right answer.
Right.
What thing that you wanted to find out, or what thing that you pursue, or fact, or story, or issue that you didn't get, the one that got away?
There are 100 of them. I mean, there's so many things I'd love to find out about. Small things often, not a particularly big moment. A number of people talked about, so her brother Craig Robinson, whom some of you probably know, was a basketball star, and he went to Princeton, and was a basketball star there, and he's been a professional, he's been a coach, he's now at ESPN. When he got married for the second time, Michelle started reading us a talk, a toast, and it was about her dad, and she couldn't finish, and Barack finished for her. And knowing how important her father was to her and is to this day, I mean, she talks about him all the time. So one example, I'd love to know what those remarks were. I heard about a speech she gave at, I think it was in support, it was, you know, the Friends of the DuSable Museum, where I'm told, but I can say this now because it's not in the book, so I don't know if it's true, but it sounded pretty interesting to follow up on, where she talked about DuSable himself and how he was gone all the time. And what did that mean to his wife? So several people recall hearing that, but nobody had it recorded or, you know. So there were any, I mean, boy, I could spend another year running down all the things that would be fun to track down.
Right, right.
Well, but she'll do that.
Absolutely, absolutely. Steve, we're going to go to questions in a couple seconds. I have a couple burning questions that I know this audience is going to particularly be interested in. Mm-hmm. Are we going to get the Obama Library based on what you know? Because you know Michelle's going to be a decision maker there.
How could they not put it here? I just want to know that. I don't know the answer, of course. I mean, in what way is that not a betrayal?
Michelle would not be a betrayer to us?
Could she be? I bet there are a few people in the audience who know her. You tell us. But everything that she talks about is anchored in the South Side of Chicago. Everything.
Mm-hmm. Even more than her husband.
So, well, certainly more than her husband, because she came up here. I mean, you know, keep in mind they first lived in Parkway Gardens, right? And you know, which itself was this fascinating, you know, historical story. But you know, her parents and grandparents were living in Woodlawn when Lorraine Hansberry wrote A Raisin in the Sun, right, about that neighborhood. So her roots run really deep here, and her experiences, you know, it was not an accident or a mistake at all. It was quite considered on her part. When she left Sidley and Austin in a big office tower downtown, because she said, you know, I could stand in my window and I couldn't even quite see South Shore. I couldn't see the South Side of my youth. So she moved from there to City Hall, where she did community development, then Public Allies, and then 12 years at the University of Chicago, where her whole, you know, her work was about connecting neighborhoods with the university and kind of making things work. And one might point out that, of course, that, you know, Barack Obama tried to do a little bit on the South Side himself. Mm-hmm. So New York, how could they do that?
But there's talk that they are not coming back to live in Chicago. That they will likely stay on the East Coast and maybe go to New York.
They have been telling their friends that they current plan. This could change, but their youngest daughter Sasha will be in 10th grade when January 20th, 2017 comes around, 3 days after Michelle's 53rd birthday, And that they have told Sasha that if she wants to stay in school in Washington and finish at Sidwell Friends, they'll stay in Washington, which is a whole interesting thing besides, given how much antipathy they have toward D.C. And that after that, New York is probably where they will end up. But they'll have houses everywhere, won't they?
And why do you think they're going to
So what they've told about, what they've said about New York is it's bigger, it's a little faster. They can be just a little bit more anonymous there. Think of the fishbowl, the bizarre life they're leading. Maybe it can be a little less bizarre, a little less, a little bit more freedom. I mean, wasn't it interesting a few weeks ago when Michelle Obama was asked, what would you love to do? And she said, well, I'd like to drive down the street in a car with the windows rolled down. I mean, is this strange or what? You know, the beast, they call it, that limousine, it is 7.5 tons. It has doors as thick as airplane doors. They are able to seal it from the outside in case of chemical weapons attacks. And she was asked, so why don't you go out on date nights more? And she says, oh, that's romantic. 20-car motorcade, right? The press is along. She says, guys with guns. The ambulance is always there. And in the trunk is actually a supply of blood with Barack Obama's blood type. She says, yeah, real fun. And, you know, Barack talks about it in the same way. You know, it used to be that he could go do, you know, wander over to 57th Street Books. And he said, you know what I'd like to do? I would like to sit on a park bench. I mean, what a world that they inhabit. So it's a wonder they would, you know, wouldn't flee to Bali. You know?
Steve? This has been great.
Thank you.
So there's more.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. And Laura, please continue to jump in with your questions as we turn to questions from you. We have a couple of students with microphones and would ask that if you're interested in asking a question, you go ahead and put your hand up. We'd like to prioritize some student questions. So if students are out there who want to ask a question first, this is your chance to do so. Any students in there? Yeah, we have a student question over here. We'll get a microphone to you. And then we'll turn to the rest of you who are with us tonight.
Hi, thank you so much for being here today. As a young woman interested in public service who's learned a lot from Michelle Obama and her story and her message, I was wondering, as a writer or just personally, what did you learn most or take away most from her story personally?
Oh, that is a great question. This was true before I started working on the book, and I admire her passion for mentoring and her sense. She tells women especially, but she tells everybody all the time, give back, help somebody else. Always be trying to make things just a little bit better. And that sounds cheesy in a way, but it's also kind of great. And she has found a way in, you know, when you think about the world that she has created for herself, first of all, married to a guy who is a little busy, where she is very much as expected of her. And of course, they both have talked about this, and I obviously write about it in the book, what the tension that created. She has done something kind of neat, I think, which is in every job she has done, she has found a way to make it work for her, both her personal life, more or less, that's the hard part, but also to have meaning. She is not about, and this is important for the way she acts as First Lady, she's not about just sort of flitting around having kind of random projects. She is about moving the needle, as she, the phrase that she uses with her staff. And so I think, you know, it's safe to say that I have learned a great deal about how important that is to her and, of course, how important it should be to all of us.
Other questions? Yes, we'll take a question here. We'll get a microphone over to you. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, good. Well, my question is, it's very interesting with the book. You talk about, one, all of the people that kind of like are against her, what she's been up to. So my question really is how do you see her leaving a legacy of all the great things that she's been doing while her adversaries might try to unravel that? Because I have a sense that that's what's going to try to happen, even with what Barack is doing, that there will be an intentional unraveling of all of what they're doing. So maybe you can speak a little bit to that, because
sure.
I think she's put some great things in place.
She is very much, she's very much hoping that these projects that she's doing, will stick around, knowing that you never know, right? I mean, this is all about what he's doing, and for that matter, what any president does. You know, you hope that your work will outlive you at least by a week and a half, right? But we all have a sense of who Michelle Obama is, and she's pretty realistic about life. She has her feet on the ground. And so I think that she is working on these individual projects, which, by the way, I think are united by a determination to make a difference for people who don't have a voice. And if you think about school lunches, who eats school lunches? Right, 70% of school lunches purchased each day in American public schools are purchased by people who cannot afford to pay the full price. These are really important meals. So not only is she wanting kids to be healthy, but she wants particularly to focus on the kids who need it most. If you think about military families, right, that is mom and apple pie. Who could disagree with that? We've just had two horrendous wars. On the other hand, she's looking for jobs for soldiers and sailors and Marines and airmen. And the overwhelming number of military personnel who are leaving the service only have a high school education. When you think about Reach Higher, which is her current effort to help kids who lack opportunity get more training, either job training or university, that too is connected with trying to make a difference for people who don't have much of a voice. So I think that she doesn't have control over the projects once she leaves, but she still has that message. And I think, frankly, this is something that she and Barack are together on. I think if you listen to their second term words, what you're hearing is a focus on a message that says, we've got to do a little bit better here, however we get there. And I think from working on the book, it is very much about who they were when they met. And in their early years of their relationship and the things they were doing in Chicago, those very same themes carry all the way through their lives.
I have a hand up here in front. We'll get a microphone up to you.
Hi, two questions. One, are you, I purchased three of those. Are you signing them after this is over?
I will sign as many copies as you buy.
And we should thank Seminary Co-op Bookstore. We'll be selling books on the table. So big thanks to them and to you.
One of the things, and again, from knowing them both long before any of this happened, can you tell me about the pieces that you ran into in constructing your story where the very legitimacy of the two of them being in the White House was such a story to other parts of America? The very thought of seeing them in the White House, or the very thought of there's a black man coming down the stairs on Air Force One. Talk about some of that part of what you encountered in constructing your story about Michelle.
That's a very good question. And some of this happens in, lights and mirrors and euphemisms and all. It's not always all that direct. I mean, let's think about the birther question, right, which I write about. I mean, it's a book about Michelle Obama, but it's about the world that they're living in together. Now, it's the most preposterous thing in the universe to imagine that Barack Obama was not born in Hawaii. Right? Is there what possible evidence could exist that not only the birth certificate was faked, but in fact the birth announcement in the Honolulu Advertiser was placed there 50 years before he was elected president by somebody who was trying to get like some fake Kenyan baby? I mean, it's like Superman, right? It's like Superman landing in Kansas. It's ridiculous, right? So, and in fact, I do say in the book, I liken it to, the persistence and so many people saying it has to be true. Some people even questioning whether, Sasha and Malia are their children. I say it's pretty much like a state trooper pulling him over in South Carolina during Jim Crow and asking for his papers. But do people actually specifically say, you can't have a black man in the White House and say it on the record? Not so often. But the evidence is awfully clear if you ask me.
One of the things you talk about in the book, too, is that Michelle particularly was up against the idea of a black woman being in this role. I mean, just like he was the first black man in the White House, she was the first black woman in that role.
and even, you know, things about her choice of clothing, her choice of, you know,
right.
Her choice of restaurants to go to.
Sure.
All that was questioned in ways that had never been done. A black woman doesn't have the right to do these
right.
things.
So the one on the, you know, who am I to say, but there are an awful lot of people in this room who know exactly what that's all about, right? And so it's hard, you know, as first lady of any kind and color and interest, you're walking a fine line. And if you are a black woman as first lady, you're walking an even finer one. And she learned that the hard way. We know that, right? We know that from February of 2008 when she said famously, right, for the first time in my adult life, I'm really proud of my country. And I bet everybody in this room knew what she was talking about. Like, what's the big deal? But needless to say, that is not how it went over. In the conservative media, you had Michelle Malkin saying, well, gosh, her background isn't that different from mine. What country does she inhabit?
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so I write about that as well. And that was mortifying to her, her friend said, because she was afraid she had hurt Barack's candidacy. And if nothing else, she didn't want to do harm. Right? She's talked, while being in the White House, she had a great question from a young girl, a teenage girl at Georgetown University, I mean a high school girl who was visiting in 2011. You know, what is it to be the first African-American first lady? And she said, well, you know, I'm really dealing with a lot of things that all first ladies deal with. But I'll tell you one thing I'm dealing with, and this was one of those moments that I was talking about before where she expressed her self-doubt and her self-awareness. She said, well, you know, I always was worried about not living up to my parents' expectations. I kind of feel the same way about the American people. I don't want to let them down, right? So if you think about that and the moment where she was so criticized for saying that somehow she had never been proud before, you remember Cindy McCain said the next day, well, I've always been proud of my country. You know, she knows about that fine line, and she is. There are things that she said about America and her perception of the inequality in America in 2007 that she does not talk about right now as First Lady. In the same way.
We'll go here, and then we've got a couple hands up back here in the middle.
Thank you so much for coming, and
sure.
Congratulations on finishing
you.
Your project. My question is really getting to the problem it is really creating a living biography and questioning not just what's happened before, mm-hmm. but what's going to come next. So for you as a writer, what do you see from this whole project is the next step in her story? Do you see it as following up on these projects mm-hmm. in a nonprofit realm or in very speculative
right.
polls going into a political route herself?
Sure. So one of the luxuries of writing, or one of the intriguing parts of writing about somebody who's alive is that it's a moving target. That makes it harder, but it also is cool. And because, after all, there are a lot of people who know her, I had access to stories in real time or, you know, very recent stories. All of that was great. But I don't pretend to prognosticate. You know, that's not my thing. Other people will write other books that will try to make those guesses. What I know from what people have told me, you know, I will happily defer to Barack Obama, who knows something about the subject, on the question of whether Michelle Obama will go into politics. He was asked, so suppose you heard 10 years from now that Michelle had gone into politics, and he would say, I would think she had been abducted by aliens. So what she has said is that she will continue to try to make a difference. She has said she wants to work on education, which she describes as the most important civil rights issue of this generation, of our generation. She will do some writing of her own, and I think we know for sure that she will be mentoring. She will be trying to work with young people, probably in this country and maybe quite possibly in other countries, kind of girl power, to kind of say what she says now to girls all over the country, which is, I believe in you, you can do it.
We have two hands up right here in the middle. We'll go one and two successively.
So Michelle worked in the University of Chicago Medical Center, Urban Health Initiative, I think she's founder. And I'm wondering if you have any views as to if she were still here, would we have a trauma center?
Mm-hmm. It's a very good question. And it's an important question, and I know how controversial that was. I write some about the Urban Health Initiative and its ambitions, and I write about some of the criticism of it. But I'm also avoiding, as I mentioned, prognostication. She's been gone from the equation for 8 years, and I don't know. I honestly don't know. I don't think we can know. You know, I think we certainly know what her thinking was, and for that matter, Valerie Jarrett's thinking was at the time. Their ambition was to create medical homes and improve and really change the way healthcare is delivered on the South Side. The goal was to have a healthier population that had places to go that were not the emergency room. Was there a reason that the hospital cared about who used the emergency room? They say yes. They say that it cost roughly $1,100 each time somebody walked into the emergency room, for example, and that that was expensive, and that they wanted to have as often as possible when someone, let's say, needed asthma medicine, to have them go someplace where they could get a doctor who could fully treat them and not have to do that. I do believe that decisions were made, not at her level, about exactly what was going to be opened and closed. But beyond that, I can't say where things would be now.
Yes, sir.
Hi, thank you for coming.
Sure.
I'm a big fan of history for a number of reasons. The biggest one, obviously, it shows us where you've been and then where we're going. One of the things that fascinates me about this particular regime is how much it reminds me of the Kennedy administration. And I find her very much like Carolyn Kennedy, probably a little more dynamic. Is that a fair comparison, do you think?
Yeah, and you mean Jackie Kennedy. Yes, is the short answer. I mean, she had a completely different upbringing from Jackie Kennedy, completely different experience. Jackie Kennedy was 32 years old when she became First Lady, right? She was only 34, 35, I can't remember now, when her husband died. Two, of course, fashion is one. But even in fashion, I think they're sort of different, because keep in mind, too, that Michelle Obama is about having fun with clothes, but also making clothes very accessible, right? Populist kind of icon, fashion icon, whereas, Jackie Kennedy was Chanel. I can't believe I'm talking about fashion. But anyway, I do not pretend to be a great expert. But I did looked into it a little bit. But there is one place where they are very much alike, and that is the notion of opening the White House to others. Now, with Jackie Kennedy, it was about having public assaults, or I'm making that up. But, I think maybe he was there, but having sort of high art in the White House and making the White House a place of performance. Michelle Obama has said, I want the White House to be open to a great variety of people who would not otherwise set foot in here. And she worked on that with Desiree Rogers, who had very much the same sense of what the White House could be. And she gave the example when asked about this. Mrs. Obama said she remembered growing up on the South Side when the University of Chicago was right there. I never set foot on campus. They didn't know who I was. It had its back to me. And she uses that example to say, let's open the White House to some kids who, they might not even drive by ever, much less come in. So when she has artists of all kinds and performers of all kinds do things at the White House, the first thing they do during the day is they do workshops with kids from around D.C. She's gotten very involved in the D.C. community. And again, all of this, I would argue, started here.
I wanted to ask actually a question about the university, if you don't mind. You write, I think, really fascinatingly about her experiences as a student at Princeton and then later at Harvard. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't help but, in sort of reading those experiences, draw connections to students here today on this campus and campuses around the country and their own search for identity in a time of political change. What were her experiences like, and how did they shape her own identity, the sense of who she was and became as a person?
So it was pretty startling for Michelle Obama, Michelle LaVon Robinson, named for her paternal grandmother. The first African-American manager, by the way, of a Moody's Bible store, her grandmother, in Chicago. She arrives at Princeton. She's 17 years old. She's come from Whitney Young, which is by design a diverse school. Many students saw it as an oasis in fact, where many students of different, you know, different races and classes would hang out together and then go home to their communities, a very different kind of thing. She gets to Princeton. She's 17 years old. The first thing that happens, and she doesn't actually, I think, didn't know this at the time, but it's a sign of what Princeton was at the time. She arrives on campus and drops her stuff. And her brother, Craig, was 2 years older at the time. He stops by her room to see if she's around. She wasn't. But her white roommate, who has not met Michelle, sees that this guy, who's rather large and black, has come looking for his sister. She tells her mom, "Mom, I'm going to have a black roommate." Her mother goes nuts and tries to get her daughter pulled out of that room and moved somewhere else. That was what part of Princeton was about. Now, to its credit, the administration did not do that. She said that Princeton made me feel more aware of my blackness than anything before. She said even well-meaning white professors and students on campus saw me as black first, a student second. She wrote her work, her thesis was about this question that will be so familiar to many people. It is, if you are an African American rising through the ranks, what is your obligation? What is your relationship to other black people left behind? And so she did her thesis on that. She then went to Harvard Law School, where her friend Verna Williams said there was a critical mass of black people where the conversations at all times, not at all times, but often the conversations were not only what is it to be a lawyer, they asked, but what is it to be a black lawyer? What law? What can law do? What again is our kind of purpose? It's this sort of conundrum of obligation. She carried all of that with her to the University of Chicago. It was obviously just as elite an organization, which had a terrible history, right, with the community, which I write about at great length. Her goal, as I write about in the book, was to try to bridge those two worlds. And she writes about having a foot in each one and we. She says, you know, we in the community and we at the university, which I think is kind of a cool use of words. Like, she fully identified with both worlds.
Let's take one more question. Laura, would you like to have the honors of the last word?
No, if there's someone in the audience, I'd defer.
Do we have a hand up back here?
No?
Yeah.
Okay.
I was just curious, first of all, thank you. This was a wonderful presentation this evening, and I'm looking forward to purchasing the book. One question, given how does Michelle Obama view the role of her husband and her husband's presidency within the context of America's two great political dynasties, the Bushes and the Clintons, given 20 prior years of Clinton-Bush, and potentially 8 years of Clinton-Bush?
Let's add that to the question you'd like to ask her. Among the questions I'd like to ask her. I don't know, but I do know that she has reflected on, quite publicly, on what makes Barack Obama different and special. I mean, she's kind of a fan. We know that. She thinks he's pretty good, pretty terrific president. She talks about that a lot. But think back to 2004, when he ran for the US Senate from Illinois. There were 7 or 8 Democrats in the race. There was an incumbent at the time, Peter Fitzgerald. Nobody gave him a shot. And then, kind of out of nowhere, you might remember, he beat all the Democrats and got 53% of the vote in the primary to get to the general, and then it was a farce because they brought in Alan Keyes, you remember, and he won by the largest margin in Illinois history. During that campaign, right before the primary, Michelle Obama was giving a speech in Springfield, Bloomington, somewhere, maybe Bloomington Normal. And she said, "Vote for my husband," for all kinds of reasons. But she also said in that speech, she said, "We're tired of giving the job to the person who has the most money and the person who has the right daddy." And she meant, you remember Blair Hull spent $29 million in that primary. And Danny Hines, who came from something of a dynasty close to the Dailies, there's much in that one statement. And if you read the things that she says about politics, about money, about privilege, If you talk, as I did, with so many people who've worked with her, who say she is always honest to be mindful of our privilege, I think you can get, you can probably divine an answer to that question without actually, in fact, anybody asking her. Does that make sense?
Well, it's a fascinating conversation. Congratulations to you,
you
on the book. Thank you so much for this conversation tonight. And thanks to Laura Washington for so expertly leading the interview. Laura, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Nice. Very nice conversation.
I want to ask everybody to stay seated for 1 second, because, Peter, I want you to be able to make your way to the table back there.
Okay.
Before the crush.
All right, yes. Thanks.
And as we mentioned a moment ago, Peter is available to sign books. The book is called Michelle Obama, A Life, by Peter, who is a professor at Medill School of Journalism at Northwestern. Also coming up, as I mentioned, we'll have a series of fellow seminars ongoing here at the Institute of Politics. Ray LaHood will be with us next week. Elsie Granderson of ESPN and CNN is with us, as is Suat Kinkliolu, who is from Turkey, a former member of parliament. Kate Grossman on education. Search online, politics.uchicago.edu, to find out more about all of that. Thank you all so much for being here. Thanks to the Seminary Co-op. Thanks, Laura, for a great conversation.
Often was she involved in those conversations, and how did she handle it?
Now, there are limits to what I know about the inside White House story, and I don't pretend to know what they're talking about at night, you know, over drinks.
You mean you didn't have a little microphone under the pillow?
No microphone, and I'm not going to make it up, right? So that was important, but there are some things we know, because he talks about it. He talks about how he values her opinion. But I also think it might be interesting to think about who Michelle is not in the White House. You know, these roles, if you walk in as First Lady, there is no playbook, right? There is no certain thing you are. It is, you have no constitutional authority. You command no armies. She is not Hillary Clinton, for example, who set out to do policy. Remember, Hillary Clinton embarked on something far more ambitious than Michelle Obama ever tried. She ran healthcare, and it, of course, went down in flames. Michelle came in and said, you know, I'm not going to be in charge of policy. That's not me. I'm not going to be Rosalind Carter, who sat in on cabinet meetings. And there are little notations that Jimmy Carter would have on some of his policy papers. What think, Roz? She's not going to be Eleanor Roosevelt, who wanted a federal job, right? What she wanted to be was to, wanted to do was carve out an agenda that was that dovetailed, that worked, that supported Barack Obama's agenda. And I think something that was true to who she has always been, which is that notion of, as I write in the book, unstacking the deck just a little bit. Mm-hmm. And you could easily talk about her policies and kind of what
well, you know,
them.
one of the policies that struck, that jumped out at me was your discussion about her position on LGBT rights and how she was ahead, along with a lot of other people, ahead of the president on that. Could you talk a little bit about that, and also are there other examples of that where she helped bring him along, or where she was ahead of him and had an impact?
I think we can look at LGBT rights as being a very consistent with who Michelle Obama is and what she cares about. When you think about how broadly she's about opportunity and she's broadly about equality, and she's seen so much in her life that is neither of those things. You all will remember that in 1996, when Barack Obama was first running for state senate for Alice Palmer's seat, he filled out a couple of questionnaires from gay rights organizations in which he was asked, well, do you support gay marriage? Do you support full rights for gay people and lesbians? And he said, well, of course I do. And that sort of went by the wayside when he entered national politics. And David Axelrod has gotten some attention in his great book, if you haven't read it, The Believer, his memoir, for saying that, in fact, he thinks that Barack Obama pulled his punches on that. And I think many of his aides think so. But Michelle was working with gay and lesbian groups attending functions as long ago as 2004 when he was running for Senate, standing in for him. And she has been a voice in the administration and in his circle who has said to LGBT organizations, this will happen, give us a little time, we're with you.
Were those public conversations?
Those were not public conversations.
Because at the time when the debate was on about whether
right.
he would step out there,
right.
I don't think people were aware that there was that behind-the-scenes conversation.
She is very careful about what she says, when she says it. She knows she's not the president. And I think it's fair to say that certainly in the first term, her goal was to make sure he got reelected. Mm-hmm. I mean, when she was in, you know, with him.
Things have changed in the second term?
I think they're very much the same people, obviously, but they're freed. They're a little bit liberated. He's not running for office again. And I think we can see in his statements, and certainly in hers, a willingness to say a little more, a willingness to talk a little more openly about inequality. Fairness and inequality, you know, fighting against that, I think, are very much what they're up to. You remember when she, you know, did the Boko Haram Bring Back Our Girls mm-hmm. thing. She went with Barack Obama when there was a demonstration for immigration rights on the Mall and was willing to say something. She tweeted on LGBT issues, you know, her support for Michael Sam's football player, to Robin Roberts when she talked about her partnership and so forth. And I think she's speaking out still carefully, you know, guardedly, but more. That's my sense, at least.
Let's talk a little bit about your research. As I understand it, the White House didn't throw open the doors and say, come on in.
I have not been to dinner over there yet. No, it is a fact.
Limited access. Talk about
sure.
how much access you got, how you
sure.
went about getting that, and then how you were able to move the book along without having
right.
and getting the information.
Yeah, I appreciate the question, and it is an answer that requires some nuance. Mm-hmm. There was sort of episodic support, some access that I got from her staff, but the vast majority of the sources, and there are dozens and dozens of them, were sources I developed myself. Many, fortunately, were people I had met while writing about the Obamas in 07 and 08, or even a little later when I wrote about the Urban Health Initiative on the South Side, who knew my work, who thought I might be okay, figured they could trust me. And I explained to everybody I interviewed what I was about, and also what I was not about, what this book would not be. It would not be a Washington book. It would not be kind of a cardboard cutout political book. I wanted to write a rich biography that was nuanced, and I also said there will be no anonymous quotes in this book. Hmm. So everything in there, anytime anybody says anything, a name is attached. And so a lot
how did,
of...
How did that promise about the anonymous quotes, how did that help you get interviews and help you get access?
You know, when you think about what I was asking, or for that matter, what any reporter asks, we are asking people to trust us with their stories. And I explained to everybody whom I interviewed that I did not want this book to be about my voice, mm-hmm. but I wanted it to include the voices of people who knew Michelle, who knew aspects of her life or of Chicago life at the same time, let's say, as her father was coming up. And in fact would be her voice as much as I could establish it from earlier interviews I did do during the campaign, as well as interviews she has given since. And so I think it probably, you know, when I'm asking people to trust me, it was helpful to be able to say, I'll read it back to you if you're concerned. I want to get it right.
It was refreshing, you're right, it's not an inside the Beltway kind of a book,
right.
And several reviewers have pointed that out, and that's a fresh, good thing. And the word I, in terms of referring to yourself, does not come up in the book at all until you get to the acknowledgments.
The acknowledgments. I do say I a couple of times.
Yeah, a couple of times, I missed those.
That's right. But, no, that was quite intentional. Mm-hmm. You know, this is not a book about me. And I conveyed that to the White House, too, when I sought access, and I would have loved to have had more access than I got. And not just to her. I mean, even keep in mind, you know, there are two fabulous writers who've written Barack Obama biographies, David Marinus and David Remnick, the editor of The New Yorker, each of whom has won a Pulitzer Prize. And Barack Obama gave them, what, an hour,
mm-hmm.
90 minutes at the
mm-hmm.
most, for 600-page books. So it wasn't about whether I could spend time with Michelle Obama. I never mm-hmm. thought that would happen. But I certainly was pleased when dozens and dozens of people were willing to talk to me, and I would have, there's still a few more, if only I could have spoken with. And some of it was just, you know, old shoe leather reporting from being a reporter. You know, I went and tried to start tracking down some of Michelle's family. And so, for instance, I went very early on to see her cousin, Capers Fune, who converted to Judaism and runs a synagogue in Englewood, and said, you know, here's what I'm trying to do. And he said, well, that sounds all right, and told me some stories about Michelle's father. And he said, well, you know, you ought to talk to Nomini Robinson. Nomini Robinson is Michelle's uncle, her father's next youngest brother. And he graduated from Hyde Park High. So I went down to Hyde Park High, you know, learned about his career. I went and saw him. And he told these just wonderful stories about the Robinson family.
Mm. Why do you think Michelle Obama would not talk to you?
Well, that's another one.
Perhaps, because they have.
You know, that's another one I can't fully answer. Yeah. They have their reasons. There are a few things that I do know. One, of course, is she will write her own book, and who doesn't want to tell their own story? I mean, that makes sense. I get
why
that.
Why give up all the good stuff?
Right.
Else?
And why give up? It would not fully surprise me if she was not hearing from her book agent, as other writers have heard. You know, don't give that stuff away. That's your meat and potatoes. But I think there was more to it than that. I mean, I think this is an East Wing being where the First Lady's office is, that is, depending on how you look at it, particularly good at controlling its message, or particularly controlling about controlling its message. They choose their audiences very carefully. They target her message in many ways. And I think when they're setting up their cost-benefit analysis, they're saying, well, what exactly is this going to do for us? Now, of course, my argument was a whole lot of people are going to read this book and review this book. And once it's out, it's not about me. Nobody cares about what Peter Slevin thinks. People are going to read it to find out about Michelle Obama. Don't you want even more of her voice in there? Don't you want to make sure that it's really right? Mm-hmm. That did not get me anywhere. I'm sorry to say. We do try.
And you haven't heard a word that we were talking about.
I have not heard a word. That is correct. I did get them books, you know, just, you know, I was very clear also. I mean, this is sort of in the context of how I presented myself. You know, from the very beginning, I said, this is a transparent project. I will answer any questions about what I'm up to. There are no secrets. There is no agenda. And so even when they were not talking with me, mm-hmm. I kept them posted, you know, books coming out, or I'm still trying to get in touch with so-and-so. And then when the book did come out, in fact, even before I sent copies to anybody else, I did send some to the White House.
Well, in this case, probably no news is good news. Because if it was something they didn't like, you would have heard from them.
There is a precedent for coming down on writers.
I want to talk a little bit about race, because that's something that, you know, you can't escape, nor should you escape in the Obama story. And you quoted very early on in the book a friend of Michelle's, Verna Williams, which I thought is this quote that really struck me, saying, so many people have no idea what black people are really like. They feel they know us when they really don't. Mm-hmm. Why did you include that quote, and how did that apply?
Particularly to girls, particularly to girls of color. And she's using the power of her own trajectory to say, you can be me, you can do this. And part of that story is not, hey, look how cool I am. Mm-hmm. But look how hard it was, and look how unsure I was, and look how many people told me, I'm not going to make it. Or they would say to me, you know, she's saying, you know, they would say, your test scores are too low, or you're not smart enough. And she said, that hurt me, that helped, you know, that was tough, and I fought back. And so it's that sense, that willingness to share that self-doubt that I found very striking.
Makes me think of that exchange that happened yesterday at the White House. Did you see the video
loved
on that?
That.
Where she was with a bunch of young children, mm-hmm. was bring your kids to work day or something like that. And a little girl asked a question, and she asked her how old she was. And Michelle, there's a little bit of a hesitation, and she said 51. And then the little girl said something you couldn't quite hear, and she had the little girl repeat it, and it was like, You look younger than 51, something along those lines.
And I bet that didn't make her day.
You could tell, but there was that little moment, of, again, that vulnerability, like, oh my God, I'm going to have to tell this little girl in the world that I'm 51, even though we know it.
Right.
And how am I going to be received? And she gave her a big hug when she gave her the right answer.
Right.
what what thing that you wanted to find out, or what thing that you pursue, or fact, or story, or issue that you didn't get, the one that got away?
There are 100 of them. I mean, there's so many things I'd love to find out about. Small things often, not a particularly big moment. A number of people talked about, so her brother Craig Robinson, whom some of you probably know, was a basketball star, and he went to Princeton, and was a basketball star there, and he's been a professional, he's been a coach, he's now at ESPN. When he got married for the second time, Michelle started reading us a toast, and it was about her dad, and she couldn't finish, and Barack finished for her. And knowing how important her father was to her and is to this day, I mean, she talks about him all the time. So one example, I'd love to know what those remarks were. I heard about a speech she gave at the Friends of the DuSable Museum, where I'm told, but I can say this now because it's not in the book, so I don't know if it's true, but it sounded pretty interesting to follow up on, where she talked about DuSable himself and how he was gone all the time. And what did that mean to his wife? So several people recall hearing that, but nobody had it recorded I could spend another year running down all the things that would be fun to track down.
Right, right.
Well, but she'll do that.
Absolutely, absolutely. Steve, we're going to go to questions in a couple seconds. I have a couple burning questions that I know this audience is going to particularly be interested in. Mm-hmm. Are we going to get the Obama Library based on what you know? Because you know Michelle's going to be a decision maker there.
How could they not put it here? I just want to know that. I don't know the answer, of course. I mean, in what way is that not a betrayal?
And would Michelle would not be a betrayer to us?
Could she be? Huh? I bet there are a few people in the audience who know her. You tell us. But everything that she talks about is anchored in the South Side of Chicago. Everything.
Mm-hmm. Even more than her husband.
More than her husband, because she came up here. I mean, keep in mind they first lived in Parkway Gardens, mm-hmm. right? And which itself was this fascinating, historical story. But her parents and grandparents were living in Woodlawn when Lorraine Hansberry wrote A Raisin in the Sun, right, about that neighborhood. So her roots run really deep here, and her experiences, it was not an accident or a mistake at all. It was quite considered on her part. When she left Sidley and Austin in a big office tower downtown, because she said, I could stand in my window and I couldn't even quite see South Shore. I couldn't see the South Side of my youth. Mm. So she moved from there to City Hall, where she did community development, then Public Allies, and then 12 years at the University of Chicago, where her whole, her work was about connecting neighborhoods with the university and kind of making things work. And one might point out, that, of course, that Barack Obama tried to do a little bit on the South Side himself. Mm-hmm. So New York, how could they do that?
But there's talk that they are not coming back to live in Chicago. That they will likely stay on the East Coast and maybe go to New York. What do you know about that? That is something that they have been telling their friends.
Mm-hmm. That they, current plan, this could change, but their youngest daughter, Sasha, will be in 10th grade when January 20th, 2017 comes around, 3 days after Michelle's 53rd birthday. And that they have told Sasha that if she wants to stay in school in Washington and finish at Sidwell Friends, they'll stay in Washington, which is a whole interesting thing besides, given how much antipathy they have toward D.C. Mm. And that after that, New York is probably where they will end up. But they'll have houses everywhere, won't they?
And why do you think they're going to
So what they've told about, what they've said about New York is it's bigger, it's a little faster, they can be just a little bit more anonymous there. Think of the fishbowl, the bizarre life they're leading. Maybe it can be a little less bizarre, mm-hmm. A little bit more freedom. I mean, wasn't it interesting a few weeks ago when Michelle Obama was asked, what would you love to do? And she said, well, I'd like to drive down the street in a car with the windows rolled down. I mean, is this strange or what? The beast, they call it, that limousine, it is 7.5 tons. It has doors as thick as airplane doors. They are able to seal it from the outside in case of chemical weapons attacks. Yeah. And she was asked, so why don't you go out on date nights more? And she says, oh, that's romantic. 20-car motorcade, right? The press is along. She says, guys with guns. The ambulance is always there. And in the trunk is actually a supply of blood with Barack Obama's blood type. She says, yeah, real fun. And, you know, Barack talks about it in the same way. You know, it used to be that he could go do, you know, wander over to 57th Street Books. And he said, you know what I'd like to do? I would like to sit on a park bench. I mean, what a world that they inhabit. So it's a wonder they would, you know, wouldn't flee to Bali. You know?
Yeah. Steve? This has been great.
Thank you.
So there's more.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. And Laura, please continue to jump in with your questions as we turn to questions from you. We have a couple of students with microphones and would ask that if you're interested in asking a question, you go ahead and put your hand up. We'd like to prioritize some student questions. So if students are out there who want to ask a question first, this is your chance to do so. Any students in there? Yeah, we have a student question over here. We'll get a microphone to you. And then we'll turn to the rest of you who are with us tonight.
Hi, thank you so much for being here today. As a young woman interested in public service who's learned a lot from Michelle Obama and her story and her message, I was wondering, as a writer or just personally, what did you learn most or take away most from her story personally?
Oh, that is a great question. This was true before I started working on the book, and I admire her passion for mentoring and her sense. She tells women especially, but she tells everybody all the time, give back, help somebody else. Always be trying to make things just a little bit better. And that sounds cheesy in a way, but it's also kind of great. And she has found a way in, you know, when you think about the world that she has created for herself, first of all, married to a guy who is a little busy, where she is very much as expected of her. And of course, they both have talked about this, and I obviously write about it in the book, what the tension that created. She has done something kind of neat, I think, which is in every job she has done, she has found a way to make it work for her, both her personal life, more or less, that's the hard part, but also to have meaning. She is not about, and this is important for the way she acts as First Lady, she's not about just sort of flitting around having kind of random projects. She is about moving the needle, as she, the phrase that she uses with her staff. And so I think, you know, it's safe to say that I have learned a great deal about how important that is to her and, of course, how important it should be to all of us.
Other questions? Yes, we'll take a question here. We'll get a microphone over to you. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, well, my question is, it's very interesting with the book. You talk about, one, all of the people that kind of like are against her, what she's been up to. So my question really is how do you see her leaving a legacy of all the great things that she's been doing while her adversaries might try to unravel that? Because I have a sense that that's what's going to try to happen, even with what Barack is doing, that there will be an intentional unraveling of all of what they're doing. So maybe you can speak a little bit to that, because I think she's put some great things in place.
She is very much, she's very much hoping that these projects that she's doing will stick around, knowing that you never know, right? I mean, this is all about what he's doing, and for that matter, what any president does. You know, you hope that your work will outlive you at least by a week and a half, right? But we all have a sense of who Michelle Obama is, and she's pretty realistic about life. She has her feet on the ground. And so I think that she is working on these individual projects, which, by the way, I think are united by a determination to make a difference for people who don't have a voice. And if you think about school lunches, who eats school lunches? Right? 70% of school lunches purchased each day in American public schools are purchased by people who cannot afford to pay the full price. These are really important meals. So not only is she wanting kids to be healthy, but she wants particularly to focus on the kids who need it most. If you think about military families, right, that is a, you know, gee, it's mom and apple pie. Who could disagree with that? We've just had two horrendous wars. On the other hand, she's looking for jobs for soldiers and sailors and Marines and airmen. And the overwhelming number of military personnel who are leaving the
Good evening, everyone. My name is Steve Edwards, the Executive Director of the Institute of Politics here at the University of Chicago, and it's so great to see all of you here with us tonight for the conversation about the new acclaimed biography of Michelle Obama entitled Michelle Obama, A Life, written by our good friend and journalist Peter Slevin, who's back in Chicago for this episode of his book tour. And he'll be interviewed tonight, of course, by Laura Washington, columnist for the Chicago Sun-Times and a recent fellow at the Institute of Politics. So we're grateful for the two of them to join us here this evening for what will be an illuminating conversation. It's part of our series of events here at the Institute of Politics, as so many of you know, where we engage many of the leading writers and diplomats and elected officials and policymakers today on key issues and players in the news today. You can find out more about all of our upcoming events online at politics.uchicago.edu. A couple of quick teasers coming up a bit later this quarter. We will have John Lee Anderson and Richard Engel talking about covering wars and conflict zones, two amazing acclaimed war correspondents. We'll also, in early June, have a session with former White House press secretaries as they reflect on their life in the eye of the storm, which should be illuminating. They'll be with us from across several different administrations. That will be coming up along with a host of other great events. Tonight's event is being recorded. You can catch all of our recorded events on iTunes U by searching U Chicago IOP. We encourage you to do that. And we also encourage you to follow us on Twitter and on Facebook. A bit later in the conversation, we'll go to questions from the audience. We'll give priority to student questions, but then we'll open the floor to all of you for your questions. And when we do, we ask that you make your question indeed a question. End it with a question mark. Keep it short and to the point so we can get to as many of you as possible. And without further ado, let me turn things over to Corinne Riley, who is a first year at the college here. She is studying history. She's from Lucca, Italy. She's very involved, not just in the IOP, but also in the Model United Nations team here. And she's also a staffer of another Model UN entity here that many University of Chicago students know. That's known as CHOMEN. Please join me in welcoming her to the podium to formally introduce our program tonight. Corinne?
Thank you so much. Once again, thank you everyone for joining the Institute of Politics speaker event out of the speaker series. So joining us today, as mentioned, we have Peter Slevin presenting his new book, Michelle Obama, A Life. The Chronicles of the First Lady's Journey from Chicago's South Side to 1600 Pennsylvania. This biography brings us details of our First Lady, not only from when she's been in office, but ever since her childhood here around the corner in the South Side. In fact, it shows us the tensions that she's faced from being, quote, frequently torn between different worlds, not just black and white, but also working class and elite, initially here in the South Side, but even later on in her life in college and in employment. Mr. Slevin is currently a professor of political science at Northwestern University, before which he spent a dozen years working for the Washington Post, covering a variety of topics such as the fall of communism in Russia and Eastern Europe, the Bush-Gore recount, and many US foreign policy topics. Joining us, we also have Laura Washington. She's an ABC7 political analyst and also a journalist for the Chicago Sun-Times. She last joined us winter quarter, in fact, as a resident fellow. I was lucky enough to be one of her fellow ambassadors, and I'm obviously very excited and very happy that everyone here has the chance to listen in on one of her discussions again. So without further ado, please help me in welcoming our two guests. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Corinne. And Corinne, I don't know if this had anything to do with your selection tonight, but I'm thrilled that you're up there today, particularly because you're so interested in history. Because one of the things, Peter, I love about this book is the way you weave historical references and the history of Chicago, history of the nation, history of the civil rights movement into Michelle's story. And congratulations on this book. a spectacular feat of reporting, meticulously researched and detailed, and I think it will stand for a long time, notwithstanding the book that I'm sure Michelle's going to do, it will stand for a long time as being a very powerful third-person rendition of her life and of the life of the Obamas, and I appreciate it. I wanted to start by thanking all of you for being here tonight, and I'm told that some of you were expecting to see the lady herself here tonight. I'm sorry, but you're not going to be disappointed. It's going to be almost like Michelle was in the room. Starting with why you did this book, obviously from Corinne's introduction, you have a very rich history in a lot of different subject areas, and this is your first book. Why this book?
First of all, thanks, Corinne. That was great. I am much obliged. And Michelle, as you all know, grew up literally around the corner, you know, just down in South Shore. Not too far from 75th and Jeffrey. And Laura, thank you. You know, I'd worked for the Washington Post for a long time, and I was doing it from Chicago, getting here wondering, like, what am I going to really write about? What's in Chicago after being in D.C.? And it was just about the time that the guy with the funny ears, the weird name, was running for the Senate, and I found that there was something, well, maybe he's sort of interesting. And in the first presidential campaign, I followed her around and I followed him around, and it just became so clear in watching her in state after state and the way she connected and the message she was delivering that she deserved a book that where she was at the center of her own narrative, not just wife of the more famous Barack Obama.
And what was there about what you saw and heard that made you feel that way? I mean, every first lady, most first ladies have had a book written about them, but why this?
There were several.
How did it speak to you?
No, it's a great question, and there were several things. I was intrigued by the way she had to give up her old identity. You know, remembering that Michelle Obama had a 20-year professional career on the South Side, 10 of them as a working mother, quite independent of Barack Obama. She then decides to back his presidential run. And he has said, and Valerie Jarrett and others have said, she had veto power. If she said no in the late 2006, he would not have run. But in order for him to run, she had to, in a sense, reinvent herself as a political person, backing his campaign, validating his campaign. And so what I saw out there on the campaign trail was her ability to connect with voters of all kinds. Remember how important Iowa was and how unlikely it was at the time that Barack Obama and Michelle Obama could win as many hearts and minds as they did. And I was fascinated by her message. I mean, she went into that campaign and said, if I'm going to be part of this enterprise, then I am going to be true to myself and my values and what I believe. And she was delivering a message that is, you know, rooted in the South Side and true today, which is she's talking about inequality, she's talking about unfairness. And I was fascinated by the way she was able to do that as an independent voice in the campaign.
Now, you talk about the South Side, where we are right now, and that being a crucial part of her identity and her success. Talk a little bit more about that. A working class family, lived in South Shore. What was there about that background that made her so impactful and successful? And how did that, how much of that rubbed off on and helped Barack Obama?
Sure. Well, that's a great question. So Michelle Obama was born in 1964, the year that the Civil Rights Act was passed. But in working on the book, I came to understand how important family was to her. She would say, you all might remember in the 07-08 campaign, the voice I hear inside my head when I'm trying to decide whether I'm making a good decision is my father's voice. So who was her father? Who was Frazier C. Robinson III, who went to DuSable High in 1953? And she talks about her mother as the rock, as the person who was sort of steadfast and disciplined and always with her. She says, I can go up to the third floor of the residence where Marion Robinson lives, and I can cry, and I can complain, and I can argue, and my mother will say, now, okay, that's fine. Now just go on and do what you're supposed to do. So the book was part of the book was to figure out, so who are these characters? Where did they come from? And that led me to her parents and to her grandparents, three of whom came in the Great Migration. And I think these values that she talks about, this tension growing up that her parents also felt, growing up in a place where in a world where the deck is stacked against her because of her race and because of her class, and yet also hearing the message from her grandparents and her parents, as her paternal grandfather said, your destiny is not written on the day you're born. Get out there, you can do it. You can be something. And that is, to finish kind of the thought that goes with your question, that's what she's talking about to this day. Those are the very same messages she heard growing up.
And how did that connect with the president? And how did that help him essentially become the president?
Well, I think there are a couple of ways to think of that. One is her friends describe her, one close friend from Chicago, also from the South Side, lives not far away, said, Michelle is the most do-what's-right person in Barack's inner circle. The president could look to Michelle and hear from Michelle how his ideas were playing. She would say, according to her friends and her staff, you know, Barack, that's not what people want to hear. That's not how you convey this. That's not how what you're trying to do will connect in quite the right way that you want. She is direct with him. She always is honest, Valerie Jarrett points out, with him, although she also says the President of the United States doesn't always need to hear me haranguing him the moment he walks across the threshold to dinner. So she says she picks her moments. But I think that she, you know, I write in the book that if, you know, you remember in 2004 when there was that, you know, he gave that soaring speech that caught everybody by surprise in Boston, red states, blue states. And, you know, he was flying high. And I write in the book that in a way, if he's the helium balloon, like she's holding the string, keeping him grounded, keeping voters' expectations in check. You know, she'll say, look, this one man cannot solve all of our problems. So she plays a lot of those anchoring roles, I think.
What role does she play in the White House? I assume that she had some say with him, some sway with him about policy, about positioning. Mm-hmm.
Service? Only have a high school education. When you think about Reach Higher, which is her current effort to help kids who lack opportunity get more training, either job training or university, that too is connected with trying to make a difference for people who don't have much of a voice. So I think that she doesn't have control over the projects once she leaves, but she still has that message. And I think, frankly, this is something that she and Barack are together on. I think if you listen to their second term words, what you're hearing is a focus on a message that says, you know, we've got to do a little bit better here, however we get there. And I think from working on the book, it is very much about who they were when they met and in their early years of their relationship and the things they were doing in Chicago. Those very same themes carry all the way through their lives.
Have a hand up here in front. We'll get a microphone up to you.
Hi, two questions. One, are you, I purchased three of those. Are you signing them after this is over?
I will sign as many copies as you buy.
And we should thank Seminary Co-op Bookstore. We'll be selling books on the table. So big thanks to them and to you.
One of the things, and again, from knowing them both long before any of this happened, can you tell me about the pieces that you ran into in constructing your story where the very legitimacy of the two of them being in the White House was such a story to other parts of America. The very thought of seeing them in the White House, or the very thought of there's a black man coming down the stairs on Air Force One. Talk about some of that part of what you encountered in constructing your story about Michelle.
That's a very good question. And you know, some of this happens in, you know, lights and mirrors and euphemisms and all. It's not always all that direct. I mean, let's think about the birther question, right, which I write about. I mean, it's a book about Michelle Obama, but it's about the world that they are living in together. Now, it's the most preposterous thing in the universe to imagine that Barack Obama was not born in Hawaii. Right? Is there what possible evidence could exist that not only the birth certificate was faked, but in fact the birth announcement in the Honolulu Advertiser was placed there 50 years before he was elected president by somebody who was trying to get like some fake Kenyan baby? I mean, it's like Superman, right? It's like Superman landing in Kansas. It's ridiculous, right? So, and in fact, you know, I do say in the book, I liken it to, the persistence and so many people saying it has to be true. Some people even questioning whether, you know, Sasha and Malia are their children. I say it's pretty much like a state trooper pulling him over in South Carolina during Jim Crow and asking for his papers. But do people actually specifically say, well, you can't have a black man in the White House and say it on the record? Not so often. But the evidence is awfully clear if you ask me.
One of the things you talk about in the book, too, is that Michelle particularly was up against the idea of a black woman being in this role. I mean, just like he was the first black man in the White House, she was the first black woman in that role. And even, you know, things about her choice of clothing, her choice of, her choice of restaurants to go to.
Sure.
All that was questioned in ways that had never been done. A black woman doesn't have the right to do these things.
So the one on the, who am I to say, but there are an awful lot of people in this room who know exactly what that's all about, right? And so it's hard, as first lady of any kind and color and interest, you're walking a fine line. And if you are a black woman as first lady, you're walking an even finer one. And she learned that the hard way. We know that, right? We know that from February of 2008 when she said famously, right, for the first time in my adult life, I'm really proud of my country. And I bet everybody in this room knew what she was talking about.
Absolutely.
Like, what's the big deal? But needless to say, that is not how it went over. In the conservative media, you had Michelle Malkin saying, well, gosh, her background isn't that different from mine. What country does she inhabit?
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so I write about that as well. And that was mortifying to her, her friend said, because she was afraid she had hurt Barack's candidacy. And if nothing else, she didn't want to do harm. Right? She's talked, while being in the White House, she had a great question from a young girl, a teenage girl at Georgetown University, a high school girl who was visiting. In 2011, what is it to be the first African-American first lady? And she said, well, I'm really dealing with a lot of things that all first ladies deal with. But I'll tell you one thing I'm dealing with, and this was one of those moments that I was talking about before where she expressed her self-doubt and her self-awareness. She said, well, I always was worried about not living up to my parents' expectations. I kind of feel the same way about the American people. I don't want to let them down, right? So if you've think about that and the moment where she was so criticized for saying that somehow she had never been proud before. You remember Cindy McCain said the next day, well, I've always been proud of my country. Mm-hmm. Yeah. She knows about that fine line, and there are things that she said about America and her perception of the inequality in America in 2007 that she does not talk about right now as First Lady. In the same way.
We'll go here, and then we've got a couple hands up back here in the middle.
Thank you so much for coming, and congratulations on finishing your project.
Thanks.
My question is really getting to the problem it is really creating a living biography and questioning not just what's happened before, but what's going to come next. So for you as a writer, what do you see from this whole project is the next step in her story? Do you see it as following up on these projects in a nonprofit realm, or in very speculative polls, going into a political route herself?
Sure. So one of the luxuries of writing, or one of the intriguing parts of writing about somebody who's alive, is that it's a moving target. That makes it harder, but it also is cool. And because, after all, there are a lot of people who know her, I had access to stories in real time, or very recent stories. All of that was great. But I don't pretend to prognosticate. That's not my thing. Other people will write other books that will try to make those guesses. What I know from what people have told me, I will happily defer to Barack Obama, who knows something about the subject, on the question of whether Michelle Obama will go into politics. He was asked, so suppose you heard 10 years from now that Michelle had gone into politics, and he would say, I would think she had been abducted by aliens. So what she has said is that she will continue to try to make a difference. She has said she wants to work on education, which she describes as the most important civil rights issue of this generation, of our generation. She will do some writing of her own, and I think we know for sure that she will be mentoring. She will be trying to work with young people, probably in this country and maybe quite possibly in other countries, kind of girl power, to kind of say what she says now to girls all over the country, which is, I believe in you, you can do it.
We have two hands up right here in the middle. We'll go one and two successively.
So Michelle worked in the University of Chicago Medical Center, Urban Health Initiative, I think she's founder. And I'm wondering if you have any views as to if she were still here, would we have a trauma center?
Mm-hmm. It's a very good question. And it's an important question, and I know how controversial that was. I write some about the Urban Health Initiative and its ambitions, and I write about some of the criticism of it. But I'm also avoiding, as I mentioned, prognostication. She's been gone from the equation for 8 years, and I don't know. I honestly don't know. I don't think we can know. You know, I think we certainly know what her thinking was, and for that matter, Valerie Jarrett's thinking was at the time. Their ambition was to create medical homes and improve and really change the way healthcare is delivered on the South Side. The goal was to have a healthier population that had places to go that were not the emergency room. Was there a reason that the hospital cared about who used the emergency room? They say yes. They say that it cost roughly $1,100 each time somebody walked into the emergency room, for example, and that that was expensive, and that they wanted to have as often as possible when someone, let's say, needed asthma medicine, to have them go someplace where they could get a doctor who could fully treat them and not have to do that. I do believe that decisions were made, not at her level, about exactly what was going to be opened and closed. But beyond that, I can't say where things would be now.
Yes, sir.
Hi, thank you for coming.
Sure.
I'm a big fan of history for a number of reasons. The biggest one, obviously, it shows us where you've been and then where we're going. One of the things that fascinates me about this particular regime is how much it reminds me of the Kennedy administration. And I find her very much like Carolyn Kennedy, probably a little more dynamic. Is that a fair comparison, do you think?
Yeah, and you mean Jackie Kennedy. Yes, is the short answer. I mean, she had a completely different upbringing from Jackie Kennedy, a completely different experience. Jackie Kennedy was 32 years old when she became First Lady, right? She was only 34, 35, I can't remember now, when her husband died. Two, of course, fashion is one. But even in fashion, I think they're sort of different, because keep in mind, too, that Michelle Obama is about having fun with clothes, but also making clothes very accessible, right? Populist kind of icon, fashion icon, whereas, Jackie Kennedy was Chanel. I can't believe I'm talking about fashion. But anyway, I do not pretend to be a great expert. But I did look at it, I looked into it a little bit. But there is one place where they are very much alike, and that is the notion of opening the White House to others. Now, with Jackie Kennedy, it was about having public assaults, or I'm making that up. But, having...
To Michelle's story.
I use that quote. Now, Verna Williams was a Harvard Law School classmate of Michelle's. She was president of the Black Law Students Association, and they were very close. And that comment from Verna Williams actually follows a comment from Michelle herself in the book. And this was in 2007, when she was just beginning the run for office. And the notion that Barack Hussein Obama could be elected was a little far-fetched to an awful lot of people. And she said, the media often distorts who black people are. We see little bits of ourselves in the media. We do not see the whole story. The fact is, she said, Barack and Michelle Obama are not different. You just haven't seen us before. And I felt that one of the objectives of the book needed to be, she's in a sense asking a question, so who are we?
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to tell that story. And you cannot tell that story without talking about race.
Mm-hmm. And when you talk about race, sometimes it gets ugly, and sometimes her story, or at least the way people have talked about her,
that's right,
or portrayed her, has been ugly. And you cite a number of examples. I'm sure everyone in this room has picked up on and heard some of them over the years.
That's right.
But things, very uncomplimentary things are said about her physical appearance, mm-hmm.
just nasty, nasty stuff. And some of it's coming from Fox News, but some of it's coming is coming out on comments on the internet.
That's right.
What was that about? Some people think that has a lot to do with race. You know, that had to do with her being an African American.
There's absolutely no question but that some of these remarks are racist.
Mm-hmm.
Now, she gets criticism. It's important to distinguish these comments and the criticism of her. She gets criticized from the left, particularly from women who say, she went to Princeton, she went to Harvard, she had a 20-year professional career. Why doesn't she do more? We've heard that.
Mm-hmm.
She certainly gets criticism for her politics. She's not shy about standing up on campaign stages and saying what she believes and what her husband believes. But there are, I document in the book, many, many examples of named individuals, inevitably all men, and in fact all Republican men, who...
All white men,
of course, who criticize her body, who say the most vile things, who share photoshopped images, who, I mean, I won't repeat them, you probably heard some of them. And I thought it was very important to put that in there to show what she is up against.
Mm-hmm.
You know, here's a job she didn't really ask for, it's a realm that she doesn't especially enjoy. Why does she have to face all of that? And yet she does.
And is she
with grace?
Yes,
I think one might add.
How would you, I know you haven't made a study of Very First Lady, but where does she fit in the ranks in terms of the first lady who had, maybe Hillary's up there too, but the first lady who's had the hardest time with her critics?
I think Hillary obviously had lots and lots of critics,
mm-hmm.
but Michelle is in, I think, and I don't pretend to be an expert on all first ladies, she is in a category by herself. You might remember her very powerful remarks at Maya Angelou's memorial service in Winston-Salem, North Carolina last year, when she was talking about what Maya Angelou meant to her as early as, you know, when she first read her poetry as a girl, or her work as a girl, her poem, Phenomenal Woman. And she learned about Barbie, and she learned about being a black woman in a black woman's body. And she said, I remember loneliness in Ivy League classrooms, and I remember moments on the campaign trail when my very womanhood was questioned. So she heard those things, and she registered those things. And I'm sure other first ladies have been criticized for any number of things, but I'd be hard-pressed to think of an example where it is as mean and as tied to her race.
It's nice to hear that, because there's some people that would debate that whether or not race is behind a lot of this, and
I really tried very hard to, you know, to play it very straight, as the book is played entirely straight, and they're just documented examples, unquestioned examples with names and dates.
Another interesting thing, and this is related to the way she is portrayed and seen, you write, and this is a quote, she was not easily characterized, and yet public reaction to her was often binary.
Right.
This interesting word, binary. And then you give a couple examples. Adore, abhor, respect, reject, warm, wise, and embracing, haughty, petty, and disdainful. These are, I assume, all words that you found that were used to describe her.
I have to say, those are words I invented.
Okay.
But I mean it, they were my synopses of how I feel she is portrayed. And she is broadly very, very popular. And in fact, she polls above 50% among Republicans as well. But she polls much, much higher among African American women and then white women. Democrats, obviously, way up high. And yet, the people who vilify her are stunningly dismissive of her. We've all seen it.
What's behind that? Beyond the race, you think it's, again, this comes back to race? Because some of this.
No, I think part of it.
Like you said about the left, women on the left who were criticizing her for not being
not
left
those,
enough.
Not in those terms. Mm-hmm. I mean, those are still pretty respectful critiques and legitimate ones, right? What role should a woman play? You know, where do you fit it? How do you balance work and family? And where do those obligations lie? I mean, that's. There will never be a consensus, I think, probably on Michelle Obama in that sense, which we could certainly talk about. But I also think, I mean, I do not think it is all about race. We are in, as everybody in this room certainly knows, we are at a time of extraordinary political polarization. And you can see how she is portrayed as, you know, the leader of the nanny state, for example. That's a democratic thing. I mean, that's the idea that, you know, she and Barack Obama happen to believe that the social safety net is something that is an obligation of society. They happen to believe that government actually can do some good work in expanding opportunity. And she made this very clear in the 2012 campaign speech, Democratic National Convention speech, which was, I argue, you know, I point out in the book, was a counterpoint to Paul Ryan and Mitt Romney, where she says that when you have succeeded, you do not shut the door behind you. You know, you open and invite somebody through, which you do personally, you do through civic work, and you do through government. And I think part of it is, you know, perfectly kind of respectable or respectful, well, not respectful perhaps, but certainly, you know, perfectly legitimate critique of her political views.
Mm-hmm. You've talked about the ways in which she helped keep Barack Obama grounded, mm-hmm. and their relationship and her connection to the community. If Michelle Obama had been white, would Barack Obama be the president of the United States?
If Michelle Obama were not Michelle Obama, he would have had a harder time being president. He would have had a harder time being Barack Obama. But to say it was just about race, I mean, that's a conversation that's harder. It's an answer that's harder to come up with. Mm-hmm. I think there are many things that she is that have been hugely beneficial to him. Part of it was absolutely about the fact that she was able to legitimize him, particularly among many black voters. She went to, you know, if you think of her speech in Orangeburg, South Carolina, which was an important primary state in November of 2007, the campaign sent Michelle Obama to Orangeburg, to South Carolina State, both because of South Carolina State's history and because she can say, listen to me, you know my history, you know my story, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about it, and I'm going to tell you why you can trust Barack Obama. And in 2012, she did the same thing again. She validated him, and she said, look, I know everything has not gone so great. He's had some tough times. He's a good man. Give him a further shot. But beyond race and, you know, appeals to sort of certain demographics, think of who she is, how smart she is, how focused she is. He says it himself, how much Michelle's voice means to him.
Anything that surprised you in the reporting? I'm sure lots of things, but what's the biggest surprise? What's the biggest surprise?
Boy,
something,
great.
A myth or something that you didn't expect or that turned you around?
There are a couple of things. I loved working on, in working on the book, I loved discovering other characters, relatives in her world. You know, the Ora Higgins, who was a great-great aunt, but was alive until 2012, dying, I think, at 101, who was hired by Spiegel in the 1940s to integrate, not just like be one person to integrate Spiegel catalogs and Spiegel stores, but in fact hire hundreds of African Americans. Or her aunt, Robbie Shields, who owned the house with her husband, Pullman Porter, a retired Pullman Porter, in South Shore, where Michelle grew up, who in 1942, as the youth choir director at Woodlawn AME, which at the time was the most progressive African-American church on the South Side, she goes to Northwestern, where she's invited to a choir workshop. And she shows up on campus, and they say, well, you can be in the workshop, but you can't sleep here on campus as a black woman. They did not use that word. So Aunt Robbie, 26 years old, tells Pastor Carey at Woodlawn AME. He gets the defender on board, and they march back up to Northwestern, and they find out what's going on. And they say, well, of course, you can't sleep here. We wouldn't allow that, not in this world, you know, you wouldn't be comfortable here, or, you know, some argument like that. Anyway, I found all of these documents about this, and so she sued Northwestern. So these are some people in her life. But if there were one thing that I was particularly struck by, it is, you know, we think of Michelle Obama as striding confidently through life. She is a force in so many different ways. She hula hoops on the White House lawn, something that, let's say, Bess Truman didn't do that often. She will feed kale chips to comedians dressed in drag. And she gives these remarkable speeches to girls all around the country. So what struck me was how often she talks about her own self-doubt and how Barack Obama said that he was attracted to her not only for her beauty and smarts, which were very real to him, but because he saw some vulnerability in her eyes. He wrote about it as the sense that life is terrifyingly random. And in this message, I think right now she is delivering this very potent and very heartfelt message all around the country and now the world. You saw she was in Cambodia recently.